Welcome back, everybody, to lecture video 6.1. This week we will look at filters in general, and now in this first video we will look at the Bayes filter, which is a direct extension of what we've seen last week with the application of the Bayes rule. So one assumption that we already made last week is the so-called Markov assumption. It states that the observations only depend on the current state. So if we have an expression like this, that we want to infer the likelihood that we make a certain sensor measurement given the whole sequence of previous world states and previous sensor measurements and potentially previous motion commands, then we can actually collapse that into the very simple expression of just p of the sensor, the probability of the sensor measurement given our current world state. And furthermore, our current state, the Markov assumption also says that the current state only depends on the previous state and the current action that we have issued. And these two assumptions are called the Markov assumptions, and they strongly simplify the dependencies between these individual random variables. A different way of drawing that is in such a process diagram or a Bayesian network, as it's also called. Here the nodes correspond to random variables, and arrows in between two random variables represent dependency between two random variables. So, for example, here in the middle, xt depends on ut because it has an arrow in between, but it also depends on the previous state xt minus 1. And the sensor observations at t, for example, only depends on the world state xt. And this is now a temporal process because we in every time step, we have a world state variable xt, we have a motion command ut, and we have a sensor observation zt. And something like this is called a process, a temporal process. And because the individual nodes are actually random variables, this is a so-called stochastic process. And and this is the model that lies behind many of the filters that we will see this week. So the underlying assumptions of the Markov filter, or the Markov assumption, are that we are actually living in a static world. So if things are not influenced by an action we are actually giving, or that we model in this vector u, then we assume that everything else stays the same. Furthermore, we assume that the noise that we have on our sensors is completely independent, because if it would be dependent, if this noise would be dependent on each other, then we would need additional arrows in between the noise variables. And furthermore, we assume that our model is perfect and that we don't have any approximation errors that again might violate this independence assumption. So, and this now is the basis for the Bayes filter. The idea is as follows. We again have a robot, for example, that goes around and takes a sequence of observations, Z1 to Zt, and during that it issues a sequence of actions or motion commands, U1 to Ut, and it is also equipped with two models, namely a sensor model that describes the mapping between how likely sensor readings are given that we are in a certain world state, and we have an action model or a motion model that describes how our actions influence the world state, and we generally assume that we are given a prior probability of the system state that is denoted by px. So if we, by the way, if you don't know, if you have to build a system like this and you don't know what a good initialization for your prior is, then typically you have, it's a good idea then to have a very broad prior that, for example, uniformly or almost uniformly distributes your belief mass. And from these assumptions here, or from this input, we want to compute the world state of the dynamic system at all times, from T1 to TT to the end, or to the current time step. And this probability then, so that's the probability of xt given the sequence of sensor observations from time step 1 to time step t is also called the belief. And so instead of writing down p of x given all the sensor input, sometimes we just write the belief of x at time step t. And now the Bayes filter algorithm works as follows. We first integrate the motion command that we have issued into our belief and create a secondary or a temporary belief variable bel bar. And we do that by applying the motion model as before, as we've seen last week. And because we don't really know what the world state is, or what the world state was at t minus 1, we have to integrate or sum up over all possible world states at this time step to make sure that we model the uncertainty that we had in our previous belief correctly. And then in the second step, we update this belief again using the sensor model. Remember, we had this denominator here actually, where we had to divide by the prior on sensor measurements, which was hard to compute. And so instead, we typically just add this normalization constant here that we compute afterwards by making sure that the belief distribution is a proper distribution, which means that it has to sum to 1 at the end of the day. Good. It should be noted here that the Bayes filter also works on continuous states. So in this case, you can just replace the sum in this equation by an integral. And also the Bayes filter works when... So although we now have here two separate steps, it can also work if you have much more actions, for example, or if they are not in sync anymore. So you can run these two steps independently, depending on how often you get motion or sensor updates. Good. And now I thought that it might be very helpful to immediately give a good example or an intuitive example of how this could look like. And I'll do that with the so-called histogram filter, or grid filter as it's also called. The goal here is that we want to localize a robot that is moving in such a grid world. We represent the world state by a state variable x that has two coordinates, so it's a two-dimensional state space where the first coordinate reflects the x position and the second coordinate reflects the y position. And we now have a belief distribution that we can visualize here as a grid as well. And the brightness now of every cell encodes how likely it is that the robot is located in one of these cells. And white means that it's very unlikely, so a probability of 0, and black would mean absolute certainty that a robot is at a certain place. And now using such a grid, we can easily model uncertainties. So for example, if we think that a robot is located here at this grayish cell, but it might also be in one of its neighboring cells, then we can use different shades of gray to indicate this uncertainty. Furthermore, we assume that this robot can move around. It can issue one of four motion commands. It can go north, east, south, and west. And the robot can move exactly one cell in every time step. And we furthermore assume that the actions are not perfectly executed. So sometimes it happens that the robot does not get to where it actually wants to. For example, if it wants to move east, wants to move to the right, even if it was perfectly certain that it was in a particular cell, after issuing this motion command, it would only be certain to a certain degree that it is still that it ended up in this right cell, and to a smaller with a smaller probability it would end up in one of the neighboring cells. So in our model we could say, for example, that it has a success rate of 60% to end up in the cell that it wants, and there is a likelihood of 10% that it moves too far or too close, or it moves one cell up or down. And then we add a special marker to one particular cell or we have a special sensor that can sense a marker that is located in one of the cells, and the robot, while it is going around, can sense this marker. You can think of that as, for example, this brightness, these lamps of the landing site that we had earlier. And because everything is a bit noisy, it might happen that the robot also detects the marker when it is one of the adjacent cells. Good. Now let's do a simulation run. Please forgive me that the shades are not perfectly reflecting the likelihoods because everything is hand-drawn and not exact. But in the next video, when we have the same, when we will do the same with the Kalman filter, you can see real probabilities being computed by a program. Good. So this is our initial state. We assume in this case now that we are perfectly certain of our world state. So we know that the robot is located exactly at this black cell here in the middle, and it now issues a motion command. It goes to the east, and for that we have to apply the first step of the Bayes filter. So we apply the motion model to our belief state, which means that we take the old belief state as input and convolve it with our motion model. This will then lead to this blurred belief state on the right, where we are pretty certain that we actually move to the right, but with a small probability it might also have happened that we moved in one of the adjacent cells. Now we apply the second step of the Bayes filter. We apply the observation model. Our sensor reported that it hasn't detected a marker, so that means that that doesn't change a lot. But actually, in the cell that is next to the cell that is next to the marker, actually gets a slightly lower probability, because we would have expected that if we are close to the marker, that there is a certain residual probability that we see this marker also from the adjacent cell. And now we walk again. In the next time step, we again walk to the right. So we apply Bayes filter step one to the motion model, and this brings us, this shifts the whole probability distribution now a little bit to the right, but it again blurs it because our motions are quite inaccurate, the result is shown in the grid on the right. And now we apply again Bayes filter step two. We apply the observation model, and in this case now we assume that the robot has observed the marker, and so we update our current belief using the sensor model, and this then results in the following distribution. So the most likely cell is now one cell to the left of the marker, but there is also a considerable probability mass on the cell with the marker. And now the question would be, you know, what do you think? What should the robot think where it is? And now you might be tempted to say, well, obviously the darkest cell is the one left of the marker. But it's actually there is actually no easy way of extracting or of specifying now the discrete location of the robot. It is a probability distribution. You can always say the most likely cell is the cell left of the marker, but in principle we can't know. It's somewhere in between these two cells. Good. So to summarize this video, we've introduced the Markov assumption that enables us to run very efficient recursive Bayesian updates on the belief distribution. It's a very useful tool for estimating the state of a dynamic system, and it forms the basis of many other filters, in particular the Kalman filter that we will now finally look at in the next video. But also other filters like the particle filter, hidden Markov models, dynamic Bayesian networks, and partially observable Markov decision processes, for example, and many other tools in statistics.